Nigeria's economy entered a recession in 2020. Well, that's no more news, reversing 3 years of recovery. But due to the fall in crude oil prices on the account of falling global demand and containment measures to fight the spread of COVID-19, the containment measures mainly affected aviation, tourism, hospitality, restaurants, manufacturing, and trade, as contraction in these sectors offset demand driven expansion in financial and information and communications technology sector. Activities in the agricultural space shows that the sector grew by 15.14% year-on-year in nominal terms in Q1 2021, while RCT sector grew by 6.31% in Q1 of 2021 from 14.7% in Q4 of 2020 and 9.99% in Q1 2020. Well, despite recovery by the manufacturing sector, other key drivers of the GDP growth rate for the Q1 2021 period recorded a decline, accounting for a slow growth rate of the economy. In order to drive growth in key sectors of the economy in the year, analysts are of the view that government needs to prioritize microeconomic stability, policy and regulatory consistency, sectoral reforms, human capital development, and all to make things better than it is at the moment. To discuss this and, of course, other economic issues, I have joining us live via Skype is the Chief Executive Officer, Cowry Assets Management Limited, Mr. Justin Chukwu. Mr. Chukwu, good afternoon to you, sir. Thank you very much for your time.
Good afternoon, Tolu. Thank you for having me.
Yes, very quickly, I want us to start with projections and reprojections that we've had in recent times. We see the World Bank and the likes of IMF going in and trying to rework these figures, considering all of the macroeconomic fundamentals. And now we are projected to grow at 1.8% and about 2.1% in 2022. 1.8 for 2021 and 2.1 for 2022. It looks to me like a very tall order. Do you see us actualizing this?
Just like you rightly said, it looks like a tall order. I think those are optimistic forecasts. Principally, if you look at the economy today and you ask yourself, well, what would be the drivers of this growth that they are projecting? In the first quarter of this year, the economy only grew by 0.51% and it grew an improvement over 0.11% in the last quarter of last year. But interestingly, the growth, like you rightly pointed out in your introductory statements, have actually slowed, and the real sector of the economy is actually slowing down. We saw a growth of only 0.79% in the non-oil sector of the economy. And major drivers of the economy are also slowing down. Agricultural sector, for instance, which accounts for about 22.35% of the GDP, grew by only 2.28%. It slowed down for about 3.42%. It grew in the preceding quarter. The telecommunication sector, which is the largest contributor to the GDP, accounting for about 14.9% of the GDP, also grew at a slower rate of 6.4%. And the trade sector, which is the second largest contributor to the economy, was still contracted about 2.2% in the first quarter of this year. These are the major drivers. The only sector that was a major contributor to the GDP that actually improved is the manufacturing sector, that accounts for about 9.9% of the GDP, that grew from a negative of 1.5% to about 3.4%. That's the only sector that actually showed material improvement in the first quarter. And again, if you look at the economy, you realize that the insecurity situation in the country is actually beginning to impact on several sectors of the economy. Obviously, the telecommunication sector, the agricultural sector, the trade sector have been in recession for God knows how long. So I do not see the propellers of this growth that they are projecting about 1.8%. I think that's quite optimistic. And the assumptions on which those predictions were based on look to be overly optimistic.
Okay, Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Okay. You were trying to make a point there because I was almost moving on. You were trying to make a point. We had some issues technically there.
Okay, what I was saying is that the assumptions on which they projected 1.8% and 2.2% growth in 2021 and 2022 look quite optimistic. If you look at issue of crude production, Yes, you could see an improvement in crude production, but you also have to look at our capacity to ratchet up production. But not only that, I do not see the world economy recovering fully as to lead to restoration of full demand for crude products. You just mentioned the issue of India, whose demand has actually declined, and it's forcing us to be looking for alternative markets for our crude. Then if you look at the domestic propellers of the economy, which is the agricultural sector that accounts for 22.3% of the GDP, the trade sector that accounts for 15.9% of the GDP, and then the telecommunication sector that accounts for about 14.9% of the GDP. You realize that all these sectors, but for the manufacturing sector that accounts for about 9.9% of the GDP, all the other sectors are actually contracting or slowing down. So, and those factors that are leading to their slowdown have not reversed or have not been addressed, principally the issue of insecurity. So if we don't address the issue of insecurity, slowdown in agriculture sector may continue. Agriculture sector accounts for almost a quarter of the GDP. A slowdown of it could actually tip us back into a recession. So I don't see this optimism. I can't relate with this optimism. I wish it is true. I pray it is true. But I think it looks overly optimistic.
Let's now move to some other factors. You've identified some, of course, insecurity and all. But now let's see some other of these factors. COVID-19, aftermath of COVID-19, vaccinations, some pickups in some of the economies, rising oil prices, and also structural changes in the oil and gas industry. And of course, the big elephant in the cupboard, flexible exchange rates. Can we take this one after the other and understand how this affects the economy in its entirety?
Okay, let's start with the issue of COVID. In as much as the Northern Hemisphere has shown very aggressive vaccination, Europe has vaccinated many of their citizens, US has vaccinated many of their citizens. But if you now extend that to a place like India, who is a major consumer of Nigerian crude, India is still going through a difficult period, which has led to a slowdown in their demand. So for you to have restoration of demand, global demand for crude, you must have the major importers of crude and have the economies revert to normalcy. India is a major consumer of crude. China is a major consumer of crude. The Western countries are major consumers of crude. So, but if you do not have a reversal of the normalcy of all the countries that are major consumers of crude, you may actually observe that you won't get to the optimum demand for crude, which means though we are seeing improvement in crude prices, it may not be sustained. And remember, as part of the improvement we are seeing in crude prices because of the OPEC Plus ability to hold together the agreement or cobble together the agreement. We hope that if demand improves further, that demand, that ability to agree on production limits will still be able to hold. So you are not sure that full demand will be restored in the next couple of months. Second issue is the issue of structural changes in the oil and gas sector. We are still discussing the issue of petroleum industry bill being passed into law. That has not taken place. And nobody is 100% sure when that will take place. Even when that takes place, it will take some time for the operators to key in to the new law and begin to make investments. It takes some time before you have the final investment decision and actual flow of capital into any sector or into any investment. So I do not see this happening this year. And even if it happened early next year, it will take some time for them to hit their first oil, I mean new investments, and then begin to export those oil, assuming demand is still there. So that's that. Then the issue of foreign exchange policies. The central bank is pushing towards some level of harmonization. We've seen the elimination of the 389 naira or so exchange rate, and we've also seen that central bank is pricing it's using the INE window as basis to price transactions. But that is one aspect of it. The other part of it is that we must earn enough foreign exchange for central bank to clear the arrears of unmet demand, as well as to create liquidity in the market, so that you will have willing buyers and willing sellers who can actually meet at equilibrium price. That's the only time when you begin to see capital flow in form of capital importation or investment from portfolio investors come back to the economy. And that's it's only when that happens that you will restore liquidity to the economy. So these factors are not things that you can actually expect that will be resolved in the next couple of months. I think anybody coming up with an optimistic expectation that GDP will grow at 1.8% on the basis that this thing should be resolved is quite a tall order.
Indeed. Mr. Chukwu, I also stay with that word. It really looks like a tall order. Now, moving on, another very worrisome trend that we've talked about also before now is the budget deficit and, of course, spike in government debt. This is also worrisome. How would this also shape recovery and stability even across the continent? We see countries trying to manage and adopt accommodative monetary and fiscal policies. How far would they go with this?
Okay, let me start the issue of adopting an accommodative monetary policy, fiscal policies.
Yes.
As we know, COVID-19 compelled many countries to now intervene using budgetary tools to minimize the contraction the economy was going to have. But that's also almost more effective where that sovereign or the nation has the headroom to invest. Unfortunately for us, we are already in a big deficit before the COVID-19 came. I'm talking about fiscal deficits. In the past six years, we've sustained fiscal deficits in our budgetary allocations year in, year out. And last year, it worsened. If you look at federal government budgetary earnings, as of November last year, total federal government revenue was only 3.47 trillion naira, at which point the federal government has spent 3.1 trillion naira in servicing debt. So, and that we are borrowing more. We borrowed about 5 trillion last year, and we're expecting to borrow more than 5 trillion this year, which means that the government's ability to service those debt will further whittle its capacity to invest in critical infrastructure sectors of the economy, critical sector that you need to catalyze economic recovery, economic growth. So the challenge we have is that because of our fiscal constraints, the government does not have the headroom to actually use budgetary tools, fiscal tools, to stimulate economic growth. And that's why the government will continue to borrow, because as long as it's not earning enough revenue from its fiscal activities, it's now borrowing to service debt, it's borrowing to meet recurrent expenditure, and whatever kobo that government spends on fiscal infrastructure is borrowed. And those are the constraints we need to realize that the country is facing today. And my position has always been that, given our limitations, our peculiar situation, we need to review our method, our approach to funding critical infrastructure, particularly those commercially viable infrastructure, and we need to take them off the budgetary process or the budgetary allocation.
Moving on now, let's now see that the big one also, inflation. Now, with rising conflicts, there are still issues. Farmers can't go to the farms, and a lot of headache along that angle. Food insecurity is something that should not come our way, but it seems like we might be facing that one way or the other. How do you see this also affecting, of course, price of food and livelihood of Nigerians who might have to pay more for petrol and have to pay more for electricity at the same time? What kind of life is a Nigerian going to live in 2021?
Well, we're already living the life of 2021. As it stands today, we...
Go ahead,
we've seen a consistent deterioration in the standard of living of an average Nigerian. Like you said, the misery index, we are dealing with high level of unemployment, about 3.3%. Yeah. You're also dealing with an inflation rate of about 18.12%. We're expecting the inflation figure for the month of May to come out today. We've not seen the figures. But then if you look at food inflation, which is more pervasive, which has more pervasive effect on average Nigerian, we are looking at the food inflation about 22.72%. Though a slight improvement from about 22.95%. But the key thing is that if you had to buy a tuber of yam for 100 naira last year, that means you have to buy the same tuber of yam, the same size of tuber of yam, for 122 naira, 72 kobo. And you ask yourself, has my income improved over the past 1 year? Has my income grown by about 22.72%? The answer is no. So you find out that what you need now to do, instead of buying a whole tuber of yam, you have to go and ask for a half tuber of yam. And if you have a household family, it simply means that the quantity of yam that each and every one of you consume will have to go down. And the implication is that you can no longer eat well, your health condition will deteriorate because your immunity level will decline if you can't eat well. Your standard of living is worsened, and the possibility that you'll get or your children will get another job, or a job has also declined because of the high rate of inflation, so a high rate of unemployment. So the reality is that when Nigerians are facing double whammy, high rate of inflation, high level of unemployment, and this has been worsened by insecurity displacing farmers from their residences of their locations, and then living in IDP. So they now live on handouts instead of living from their farming activities.
Now, I also wonder, a country with all of these challenges, we're not limited to Nigeria, a lot of issues too across the globe, but focusing on Nigeria, what's the position of foreign direct investment at this time with all of the insecurity issues and uncertainties? Even investors, some are sitting on the fence.
Yes, absolutely. One of the things about investment is that you need to be able to deal with the risk you understand or you can deal with. When some of the risks are beyond you, when they are a strenuous risk, sovereign risk, you need to weigh the return from that environment with the risk you want to take. So you talk of risk return metrics. As it stands today, we've seen an innovation in our risk profile. Our sovereign risk has worsened because of higher level of insecurity. And the return environment has also declined. So you can't talk of going to an environment where you have higher risk and where it decline, returns also decline. We talked about the GDP growth of 0.51% in the first quarter of this year at a time when you're having a limited risk. So investors, particularly those who have choice, those outside the country, will rather sit on the fence and watch you address some of these systemic problems before they come into your economy. Added to the fact that they have FX liquidity to deal with, some of them are straight trapped and can take out their FX. That's for foreign portfolio investors. But for direct investors, they are looking at the security situation. They are looking at the stability of the country. They are looking at all the returns in several sectors of the economy. I mentioned the issue that agriculture sector has actually declined in terms of return, in terms of growth from 3.42% to 2.28%. The manufacturing sector is growing about 3.4%. Telecommunications sector growth has dropped to 6.6%, and then trade is still in recession. So these are factors that investors will look at before they come into this economy. Unlike the past, when we used to have growth rate that averaged close to 7% over a period of more than 5-6 years, and that was an incentive for investors to say, I can take the risk. But now you have low risk return environment at the same time you have a limited risk.
Despite all of these odds, again, analysts like you, professional analysts, will still come up and tell us that we still have prospects. There's prospects for Nigeria's economy. Where does this prospect lie, and any silver lining for us at this time?
Well, what I'll talk on the prospects. The prospect is because we are a large market. If the economy starts working with a population of more than 200 million people, it's a market for consumer products, because principally, if you can have your consumer product, you sell to only 1% of the Nigerian population, you're selling it to how many? You're selling it to 2 million people. And if you can attract it to 10% of the Nigerian population, you're selling to 20 million people. That is more than the population of several West African countries or several countries in Africa. So you have a huge potential market, but that market is now suffering from very low purchasing power, eroded by inflation, eroded by exchange rate devaluation. So if we address these things, which are solvable, the issues, then we can begin to explore this potential. The size of the population is a huge market. The size or the demography of the population in terms of age distribution is also a huge potential, because you can actually have a strong labor force. These are potentials that we have, but they can only be mined if you can create jobs for this population, if people earn income so that they can spend those income on consumption, and then you have a huge market.
Right there is a good way to leave it there. Mr. Johnson Chukwu, thank you very much. It's always a pleasure having you on the show. Chief Executive Officer, Cowry Assets Management Limited. I appreciate your time. Enjoy the rest of your day, Mr. Chukwu.
My pleasure.